Good afternoon, everyone. First, I would like to thank Linda Reinstein for having invited me. It's an honor for me to participate to the ADAO annual conference. I'm a PhD candidate in anthropology at the University of Bologna in Italy. My background is in medical anthropology, and I research on practices of suffering and struggle in contexts where asbestos manufacturing and pollution have caused environmental and social disasters. I've been carrying out a multi-sited ethnographic investigation, which I started in Italy in 2009 and continued in Brazil, where I did fieldwork last year. In Italy, the investigated contexts were Bari, my hometown in the south, and Casale Monferrato in the northwest. In Brazil, I was based in Osasco, a city of 700,000 inhabitants bordering the megalopolis of São Paulo. Because of the presence of asbestos cement factories, asbestos pollution has significantly contaminated each of the three settings. In Bari, the Fibronit plant, now in disuse, is located in a very densely populated neighborhood. We can see it surrounded by buildings, schools, public offices, and railways. It is a familiar and thus invisible fixture in the neighborhood landscape. Later, I will comment on how this invisibility can worsen the effects of asbestos pollution on an exposed population. The decision to continue my study in Osasco was rooted in my previous investigations, and in particular was influenced by the connections I found between the anti-asbestos activism occurring in Osasco and in Casale Monferrato. In fact, both Casale and Osasco were homes to the largest asbestos cement plants in Europe and Latin America, both owned by the firm Eternit. The consequences of decades of large-scale asbestos manufacturing have created disaster contexts. I've used an anthropological definition of disaster in my research. I refer to the effects of asbestos manufacturing as disaster not only because of the number of asbestos-related deaths registered all over the world, 107,000 per year worldwide, but also because of the extent of the private and social suffering related to it. These disasters are still not recognized in most of the contexts in which they have occurred and continue to occur because of an invisibility that pervades them in several aspects. For instance, first, in relation to the invisibility of the cancer-causing factors, as the asbestos fibers. Second, in the relation of the slowness of the occurrence of the disaster's effects due to the long latency period of asbestos-related diseases. Third, in relation to the uncertainty of biomedical knowledge about diagnosis and treatment of mesothelioma. Fourth, in relation to the inadequacy of epidemiological evidence, and finally, in relation to the absence of risk perception. However, in some circumstances, asbestos sufferers, men and women with asbestos-related diseases, their loved ones, and communities affected by serious asbestos pollution, engage in activities that impact the socio-political context in which these disasters occur, and as a result, make them visible. My research hypothesis stems from an anthropological investigation of their body, social movements, and contexts affected by disasters. Through this theoretical lens, anti-asbestos activism can be triggered by the crisis caused by the suffering experience. Such a crisis can provoke the disruption of one's world in terms of physical decay, rupture of affective relationships, and anguish due to the awareness of being at risk of contracting a serious cancer such as malignant mesothelioma because of a past exposure to asbestos fibers. The crisis related to the experience of disaster represent an occasion to reflect on our taking for granted world, and it brings with itself a potential of critique that in favorable circumstances can flow beyond one's world, one's body, and effective relationships, and pervade the surrounding context, affecting it and changing it. The majority of my research collaborators from all contexts have described their engagement in the anti-asbestos activism as a new urge. I quote an interview conducted in Casale Monferrato in 2012. Quote, "After seeing such a suffering, you have to do something. If you do not do anything, you feel guilty. It's like leaving them, people passed away because of asbestos-related diseases, without burial." End of the quote. Such an urge is lived through practices that are inexorably influenced by the uniqueness of each context, by the subjectivities involved, and by the contingencies defining new possibilities and encounters each time. In Osasco, for instance, the activists of ABREA, the Brazilian Association of Exposed to Asbestos, are struggling for the recognition of asbestos-related suffering and asbestos banishment in the whole Brazilian territory. I took this picture in Osasco last April during an awareness campaign. Every April, the ABREA activists mount a gazebo in the main city square. They talk to people about asbestos dangers and show them asbestos-containing products. They exhibit large portraits of their friends, wives, fathers, and husbands who have died from asbestos-related diseases. In Osasco, where the majority of my research collaborators have been elderly male former workers with at least one asbestos-related disease diagnosis, the meaning of one's personal engagement was explained to me in the following terms. On one hand, as something connecting to the friendship, respect, and love for those who already died. On the other hand, and something necessary to guarantee a better world for the next generations. The reference to one's own mortality and to the wish of doing something to overcome it was a constant element in most of the conversation I had in Osasco as well as in Casale Monferrato. In Casale Monferrato, where the civil mobilization began 30 years ago and asbestos contamination affected almost every family of this beautiful tiny town, the struggle led to the first big trial against one of the most powerful asbestos cement corporations in the world. On November 19, 2014, I was in Rome together with sufferer activists from Italy and Brazil, and together we witnessed the verdict of the Supreme Court of my country, establishing that the crime of environmental disaster did not exist in Casale Monferrato. This was despite the previous two sentences pronounced by the Court of Turin, recognizing the crime of environmental disasters manslaughter. On that day, the suffering of thousands of women and men had once again not been recognized. Once again, sufferers from the effects of asbestos manufacturing on environment and health had been subjected to another act of legitimated violence. However, the importance of the civil mobilization that had occurred in Casale Monferrato, together with the organization of the trial, remains an example for all anti-asbestos activists around the world. For decades, in fact, AFEVA, Association of Relatives and Victims from Asbestos in Casale, has been promoting campaigns locally as well as positioning itself in the international scenario of anti-asbestos activism. The interesting and strong connections existing between AFEVA and ABREA nurtured my interest to continue the study in Osasco. Over the years, my intellectual curiosity and my passion for anthropology molded my personal, political, and moral commitment to the men and women I met, into the study of anti-asbestos activism. As anthropologist, I'm aware of the collaborative and participative dimension of the knowledge that emerged from my encounters in the field. At the same time, I believe that the responsibility and value of anthropology, as of any science, reside in its attempt to improve the world we live in by making public its contribution. In conclusion, I refer to my fieldwork in Bari, where my intellectual curiosity and personal engagement had begun. The Bari Diafeva, founded by Angela and Lillo Mendola, is an association with the following aims: to share knowledge, to lobby for funding experimental trials, and to give support to men and women diagnosed with malignant mesothelioma and their loved ones. It operates in a context where, despite the increase of suffering, asbestos-related disasters remain almost invisible. I realized that I was myself an exposed citizen only during the study for my master thesis that was focused on the investigation of malignant mesothelioma experiences related to environmental and not occupational exposure to asbestos. I became friends with Lillo Mendola, then current president of the Diafeva Bari. With him, I have exchanged opinions and knowledge. Our discussion have helped both us to forge our personal view on the complex and multifaceted process in which we are involved, me as a researcher and him as a husband of a woman with malignant mesothelioma. When I told him that I would participate in the ADAO conference, he said, "Please talk about Angela, don't forget her." I've never forgot Angela, nor the encounters with Romana, Mariuccia, Eliezer, Giselle. Their stories have been fundamental to understanding and facing the disasters caused by asbestos manufacturing. I asked Lillo to send me this picture that he had shown during a presentation he had given at a conference I organized in Bologna in 2014. In the picture, Angela was in the hospital and she had asked to be photographed. She died in October 2009 after months of atrocious pain and anguish. Before that, she had been going to the association meetings even with a portable oxygen tank up until she could no longer leave the house. In his presentation, Lillo, while showing this photograph, referred to a non-academic article I had written. I'd like to conclude with the same words that summarize well my understanding of anti-asbestos activism. Activism is important because it is crucial not to deny the strength that still emanates from a body that does not resign to be only a victim. Instead, through its torment, the body wants to leave a reminder and a message of hope to those who survive. Thank you for your attention.